Welcome to today. Welcome.
Thank you, Pierre.
It's good to have you here.
Thanks very much.
And you have come from Atlanta direct to Oslo,
right,
to get with your team. Mm-hmm. And you have had a block in this apostolic network, C-WBN.
Right.
Can you just share a little bit first about this apostolic network?
Right. Well, we our name is Congress-WBN or C-WBN. And we're an apostolic network, but we're also a network of businesses, institutions, schools, kingdom businesses. We do a number of different things because we are convinced that God wants to impact not just the church, but also the systems of the earth. And so there has to be ways to organize life and humanity so that the Spirit of God can work through us, not just as pastors or as prophets or as preachers. He does that, but also as business people, as educators, as consultants, as all kinds of different incarnations of the Spirit of God. So the Congress is a collection of many networks, all forming one cohesive demonstration of the kingdom of God. So when Paul writes in Ephesians, he says that the manifold wisdom of God must be made known to the principalities and powers in heaven. The word there means the multifaceted or multivariegated dimensions of who God is. God is not narrow or singular. He's big and he's broad. And he has purpose for all the systems of the earth. And he has opinions or ideas about how business should be run, about how nations should conduct themselves, about how he wants our children educated. And so our desire is to receive from him wisdom and understanding about those things and release them into the systems of the earth. So the Congress is all those things. In the midst of all those things, we have a network of churches. And the seminar this weekend was gathering the pastors or the senior elders of our churches, bringing them into one place that we could equip them in the prophetic. And so that's what we did for the last 2 days, yesterday and today, in my first visit here to Norway and Oslo. Very, very powerful, very successful, very impartational. So it was teaching, but it was imparting the dynamics, the power of the Spirit, of the new prophetic dimension into our leaders, the senior elders.
Yes. How is it that you have chosen Oslo as the city for Northern Europe?
Well, it's where the people are. I mean, people are gathering around Oslo. I think that we had very little activity here over the years. It's only been the last year or two that we decided we wanted to come to Norway, Oslo, and gather pastors. We had an engagement seminar in 2015. That's where you got introduced to the Congress, and you came into relationship with us in the Congress, which we were very glad for, Pierre. And so it's where pastors are. It's where people are. It's not that there's anything that's more or less strategic about any place in the earth. God loves everybody. He wants to appear to all of us. So we work in Oslo. We work in Stockholm. We'll be going to Stockholm tomorrow for a gathering of people. We have a base in London. We have a base in Geneva. And then all across the earth, we have 105 nations that we're working in. And so Oslo happened to be a good place to touch down, to gather pastors and bring people together.
Thank you for coming. And this team for this particularly prophetic block that we have been a part of, that was really, how can I say, I feel it was a new view to hear the teaching. And for me, for example, this we have during the last decades been very focused in hearing the voice of the Lord, focus on the ministering giftings, and that is of course very great to see how that can affect people. But still, we have seen maybe at least in this nation, not just that people are just running after prophetic. It's also like we have seen in some of these new movements, it's very oriented in to be blessed and to have some experiences with God, but without commitment and changes. So I feel this seminar has been really great in that way. So can you summarize that in some words?
Yeah, I'll try. It's a big subject, and we talk about this a lot because because like you, I have a background in the prophetic where we released a lot of prophetic words. We believe that God was beginning to restore the voice of God to his church, and apostles and prophets are coming back into correct order. But as you said, we found that a lot of times the way it happened, was that people gathered and they received many blessings and many words and many manifestations and many miracles, all of which is good, but it was seemed to focus on the power of the moment. It didn't focus on the power of a developmental process. So things devolved sort of into people seeking repeated experiences in the voice of God, repeated getting prophetic words. And so we had prophetic seminars and conferences. People came from all over the world. I'm sure they came to your location here. They came to locations that we had across the world. And it was a good desire to hear the voice of God, but we did not yet have apostolic understanding about how to build people. And so what we've done is we've learned that when God talks, the primary manifestation of the voice of God is human transformation. If God talks and people don't change, something is the matter. So in the very beginning of the Word of God, we have the book of Genesis where it says that the earth was formless, it was void, darkness covered it. So this is like it could be a metaphor of a human life that it lacks purpose and lacks understanding. But then God spoke and light came. God spoke and life sprang forth. God spoke and he created life. So you have the voice of God coming. But when you read the book of Genesis, the first few verses, you don't sit and marvel at the manifestation. You don't say, wow, the voice of God. Our attention is drawn to the power of the creative act as transformation. And that's how the voice of God comes. When it comes to my life or your life, it changes us. So you have Paul. He's a murderer and a blasphemer. God talks and he changes. His name changed. His heart changed. His mission changed. And that's a primary experience in the New Testament. In Moses, you have a man who was filled with anger and his own strength, and God talked and he changed and he became a deliverer. You have Jeremiah, who's a priest and he's afraid, he's intimidated, and God talked and he changed. It's like every time you look in the Word of God and you see the voice of God come, it produces transformation. And we can call transformation, what we would call it is we would say that there's a building dynamic of the prophetic, not a blessing dynamic. So he doesn't talk just to encourage us, although we are encouraged. He doesn't talk just to bless us, although we get blessed. His primary purpose for talking to us is to transform us, to make us like him. So therefore, when God talks, it needs to set me on a journey of growth and development. And if it's really God talking, that means that the result of his talking is I become more like him. God's not going to talk and make me more unlike him. He's not going to talk and make me immature. When God talks, it doesn't make me carnal. It makes me more spiritual, more healthy, more Christ-like. It strengthens my marriage or my identity, my manhood. And so that's our approach, is that we don't just want to hear the voice of God and rejoice that we're hearing manifestations. We actually want to move towards fullness of maturity for my individual life, my marriage, my church or kingdom community, and for God's purpose on the earth. So it's much more building oriented, much more development oriented, and I find it much more fulfilling because it is doing what God really wants us to do with the prophetic.
Yes, I think in the streams that we have had maybe in many years in the churches, that we have been focusing in the, you know, the evangelical, especially here in Norway, the evangelical side, where we have focused to bring people into the church. But the discipleship has not been there, or we have had maybe the teaching, but how I have experienced being part of this network the last 9 months is that it's actually a grace to download,
yes,
the how can we say, the methods or the blueprint,
yes,
and that, you know, authority,
yes,
behind the teaching,
right.
That bring transformation.
That's right. And the change for us, we can track the changes because we were a part of the prophetic in the 1980s, before apostles were really restored and functional. So we know what it was like then, and it was authentic, it was God. But if you're following God, he expects you to grow and migrate and change, never to get fixed in some old position. Like you and I have talked about, some of the early reformers who God raised up here in Norway and across nations of the earth. And they were reformers and men of God for their time. But now here it is 50 years later or 200 years later, and God expects his church to go past what they did. We have to come into a new move of God. And so the process of migration and growth means that we're not satisfied with the outpouring of the prophetic in the 80s and 90s. And a significant difference between that prophetic order and what we're seeking to embrace and build today is the difference that comes when true apostolic functionality gets restored. So apostles are called builders, apostles are called architects, and apostles are also called first. So in 1 Corinthians 12:28, Paul writes, God has set in the church first apostles, secondarily prophets, thirdly teachers, and he goes on and makes a list. Now that list is not a list of most important and less important. You're not better if you're first than if you're fifth. Because you can't have, there's no inferior or superior dimension of Christ. You can't say the apostle is better than the prophet because they're both Christ. It's simply a ranking order that God has established in order to build his church properly. The problem was, in my background in the prophetic, I was a prophet and I was prophesying, but I didn't have apostolic grace defining me. There was no first apostle. And so I use the image of a staircase. If you have a staircase in your house or your office, you have a first step, you have a second step, you have a third step. So if you say apostles are first and prophets are second and teachers are third in that order in Corinthians, if you take away the first step, the question you could ask is, well, are prophets now first? And the answer is no, because the Bible says they're second. Well, can you say, are the prophets second? Well, the answer also is no, because there's no first that's there to define it. So what we had is we had prophets that were authentic, but they lacked definition. They lacked fullness of context. So when God then restored true apostles, it provided that context. And it caused a massive reshuffling of all ministries in the body of Christ. Not only prophets, but pastors are now being redefined and coming into new identity and new power to build in their kingdom communities. They always wanted to build. Any pastor wanted to build the people and desired to mature his people. But now, because we have first apostles and second prophets and all of the ministries are functioning correctly, now pastors are equipped to build and to mature the people, not just in their own individual gifting, but in relationship, in collaboration with the other ministries. And so it's a very redefined world in 2016. It's different than 1990. It's different than the year 2000. It's a new day of prophetic competence, operations, pastoral competence and operations. And so what we're seeking to do, Pierre, as you saw the last 2 days and through the many blocks that you've been a part of, is we're seeking to really impart to pastors that new competence, that new strength, to really move the people towards maturity. Dr. Woodruff says many times, he says people will not spontaneously evolve towards maturity. They have to be led there. Well, that's our job as pastors, as leaders. It's the job of every senior elder to lead his people towards maturity. They're a portal into the lives of the sheep and the people. We want to equip those pastors and their people with the power of apostolic grace and really reform the body of Christ to make us mature so that when we're finally at the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, he can come back.
That's wonderful.
Yeah.
I think one sentence that I got from one of Dr. Woodruff's teaching, I guess it was, that statement that we have to desire to be the generation that will fulfill all the prophecy.
That's right.
And see the final.
Yes.
I think that's a good statement.
Yeah, it's beautiful. We're moving towards a culmination or a finish. There is a termination point of human history. It is the coming of the Lord himself. But he's only going to come when he sees the quantity of maturity and strength in his body that he has destined for it to achieve. So we have to move towards that. We have to release that. So it's not just conducting ministry in order to, you know, build a good church or a good ministry. It actually has a very clear point of arrival. Arrival, we call the finish. The finish of all things is actually the coming of the Lord, returning for his bride to take us out of mortal structures and to release in us eternal life in all aspects of life, in our bodies, and to have a new heaven and a new earth. So that's what maturity means. In the book of Ezra, it says that there was prophets with the elders, and they were partnering and collaborating. And it says the prophets came alongside, and they helped the elders build. And it says they built the temple, and they finished it. The problem before was they were building, but they had opposition. They were opposed. They were stopped. They became afraid, because the enemy does not want God's people built. He wants to keep us broken. He wants to keep us immature. He wants to keep us scattered. He wants to keep us in racial enclaves. He wants to make us immature and unable to achieve Christ-likeness. And God sends prophets, and the voice of God, it says, you can build, you can do it. You can begin to construct the purposes of God. And it says they built it and they finished it. If you're building something, it has a point of completion. Otherwise, you're forever laboring. And so God is building his church through his leaders, and we are going to achieve, and we're moving towards that point of achievement, of finishing. What is finishing? It's all of us being as mature as he wants us to be, moving towards that place. So the imagery is that you have the power to journey. You have the power to change in your life, in your marriage, in your church, in your business. And the voice of God comes, and it partners with us to help us achieve that place. And so for us, therefore, the prophetic is very different than simply giving out words and blessing people. We don't want to do that as a primary focus. Our primary focus is, what is God saying to cause you to grow? What is his purpose for your life? How are you developing? And then once he's talked, now we have to look at, well, how do I have to respond now? Because every time God talks, he expects a response from us. He doesn't walk away and just hope that we get it. He has something in his mind that he wants us to offer back to him. And so we would also talk about that with our leaders, with our people. Now that he's spoken to us, what does he expect of you? And there's a number of things that we could talk about in that regard, but there's a point of termination and a point of finish, and we have to move towards that. And you see that not only in the church, but you see in the nations, we're moving towards the end times. We're living in the end of times right now. I mean, we're living in a time where nations are crumbling, economies are vulnerable, politicians don't have answers. No matter what nation you live in, society is decaying morally. There's no reverse gear in God. You know, the scripture from Isaiah prophesied, and he said, like the rain and the snow fall from heaven upon the earth, and they water it, and they bring forth seed for the sower, and also bread for the eater. So you see a process there. It produces seed, it produces bread. There's a sequence that when rain falls, it bursts things upon the earth. So is my word that comes forth from my mouth. It will not return to me void. It will accomplish the purpose for which I sent it. So when God talks, when he speaks, there is an ultimate objective that he wants to accomplish. And that objective is the finish of all things. It's the culmination of all things. It's possible to move towards full completion. So in other words, to use the metaphor of Isaiah, of rain falling is like the word that comes from God. Rain doesn't fall up. Rain falls down. There's no reverse gear in God, which means that there's no getting out of the crisis. There's no going back to life as it used to be in 1960 or 70. There's no more stable nations in the future. We're moving towards instability. We're moving towards chaos in the earth, but God's people are being equipped and they're being strengthened because we have a decisive endpoint. Nations being broken, you and I, the body of Christ, the entire church being strengthened. And that's our destination. And there's no other way to go but that direction.
I mean, that view will change our way to intercede and pray for the nations and
yes,
our
yes.
way. So I mean, because it seems that much of the prayer movements and gatherings,
right.
we are focusing maybe on wrong things, praying right. for wrong things because we don't have that that view. And see that linear
yes.
Way to accomplish everything.
Yes. Yeah, that's right.
So, yes, I think we shall have some music, and then we have some other questions also.
Sure.
So we have prophetic music. Glory shall come forth.
Stå prestastig
Thank you, Ida, for that music. It's good to have you here in studio, Scott.
Thank you. Yes,
I think we could speak a little bit more of this iceberg principle that you shared about in this seminar block, because I think that will explain some very important things to achieve a more authentic and authority in right. the prophetic ministry.
Oh, sure. The iceberg principle. I mean, if anybody should understand the iceberg principle, it would be Norwegians, because there's so much ice here. As we're talking, it's April. Is it April?
Is it?
It's April, yes, right? It's April. And I live in Atlanta, Georgia, and the sun is shining, and the gentle breezes are blowing, and it's warming up during the day. Very pleasant, very nice. It's still spring in Norway, means there's still ice on the fjords. We were driving up and I saw some ice. And so an iceberg principle means that an iceberg, it's a very big entity, very big thing, but only 1/10 of it can be seen above the waterline. So if you can imagine the waterline here, and this part that you can see is 1/10. Beneath that is a huge mass, the hidden 9/10, we call it. And if you think about what is God more focused on, is he more focused on what you can see or more focused on what is hidden? And the word of God is very clear that God is always more focused on the hidden 9/10. And you see that in the word of God. For instance, when he tells Samuel, don't look upon the outward appearance of a man. Man looks upon the outward, but God looks upon the heart. So when God is assessing who would be a good king, he's not looking for their military prowess or their education. He's looking for a David who has a quality heart. That's the hidden 9/10. You can't see a man's heart. I can't see your heart, Pierre, but I can see the quality of your heart through your actions. And I know that inside you have a pure heart and you have a right heart. You can't see a person's mind, but you can see the manifestation of their thinking. So the hidden 9/10 is an icon, the iceberg is an icon that we use to say that the developments of the inner man are more important than his outer operations. In the prophetic, what that means is that we're not really focused on, you know, what you actually do. Do you have a dream or do you lay hands on somebody and prophesy? Those are external operations that are good and they're correct. But it's the thing that's changing is not the activity, but the hidden 9/10 beneath it. And I guess the best way to explain it would be to refer to an experience that I had. Actually, I was in the UK. We were in London. This is about 10 or 12 years ago. I was with my good friend, Paul Linda, who's here with us in the audience today in the studio. And Paul and I were conducting a prophetic seminar, very similar to the one we did this week. And we had gathered all of our pastors from across the UK. And we did some teaching, and then we prophesied to them. Now, I had been involved in the prophetic for a few decades before that. So I was familiar with the activities, you know, and the activities didn't change. We prophesied to people, we did teaching, but as Paul and I and our team functioned, we laid hands on our first pastor, and as I was ministering, it was kind of strange because it was almost like I was ministering, but I was also standing outside of myself watching myself minister, and I could see that I was different and we were different than what I had known before. The voice of God had more authority. It had more clarity, not so much more accuracy in detail, because God always speaks accurately, but it was coming from a different place. And I was trying to find ways of describing how is it different? Because the activity is the same. It's kind of strange. So I sat down and I began to write a report. And as I began to identify things that were different, and I said, I identified it was much more of a building focus than a blessing focus. That was a significant change. It was much more corporate than individual. We weren't driven by individual demand. Nobody was saying, give me my word. We were all saying, let's see what God says to us, even though he was talking to individual pastors one by one. We actually manifest as, in between some of the prophetic ministry, we would stop and take commentary, identify principles, and realize that when God was talking to this man or this woman, he was talking to all of us. Through principle, through ethics, through revealing his nature. Because when God talks, he expects us to look for the one that is talking, not just listen for what he's saying. So there's a verse in Samuel that says that that Samuel did not yet know the Lord. The Lord had not yet revealed himself to him. And the word reveal is a word which means to unclothe yourself and to make yourself bare. And God had not yet revealed himself to Samuel. But then God talked to Samuel, and we know what happened. He spoke to Eli, and judgment came upon the nation. And after that, it says that all of Israel knew Samuel was established to be a prophet of the Lord. And then it says God continued to reveal himself to Samuel through his word. So he didn't reveal himself to Samuel just turning up in his house. He revealed himself through his word. So therefore, when God talks, what he really wants is us to see him. Seeing him is not what he said. Seeing him is the principle or the ethic or the value behind what he said. So therefore, let's say like today we were prophesying to senior elders. We were together in the meeting. And there was a word to one senior elder about going into neighborhoods and ministering to people with addictions and empowering people economically, helping the disenfranchised. So that's the word. And what is the revelation of God through that word? Well, the revelation of God is that he is redemptive. He wants to heal people. He wants to set them free. He's our Father. He cares for humanity. He has compassion. Now, that God is a God that all of us can come to know, because he has compassion for my life and for your life, just like he has for the people in the neighborhood. So it's more important to see who God is than to get a word from God. Yes? Because to get a word from God gives you information. To know who he is gives you revelation and insight. And when you see God, you change. So that's part of the hidden nine-tenths. So it changed our prophetic operations from primarily delivering words to people. We still do that. But in doing that, what we're really doing is delivering God to people. It's much more holistic. It's much more robust. It's much more correct. It takes people's eyes off of a gift and it puts their eyes on God. It takes people's eyes off of a prophet and puts their eyes on the God behind the prophet. It removes any sense of the prophet being a celebrity or a performer or great, so to speak, in a carnal way. And it puts the focus on God being great, on God being redemptive, on God being our Father. And so that's the hidden nine-tenths. The hidden nine-tenths is, who is this God that we see talking? We see him talking, we hear him talking, but we want to discover him. We want to look for him. And if you don't look for him, you don't find him. The word of God is very clear. If you look, you will find. If you knock, the door will be opened. If you ask, it will be given. And of course, the inverse is true. If you don't ask, you receive nothing. You have to ask, you have to seek, you have to knock. And so it's returning to the church a correct pursuit of God, not a pursuit of ministry, not a pursuit of words, a pursuit of God himself. So when he turns up and he talks and we prophesy, it produces a sense of correct fear. It produces sobriety. It produces a sense of humility, regard for God. It makes the prophetic less frivolous and foolish. It makes us powerful and ponderous and wise. So that's what we mean by the hidden nine-tenths. That's a little explanation. And so we have a series of principles that we use to describe what are those definers of those hidden nine-tenths. We call them core definers. And that redefines our iceberg, our hidden nine-tenths. And once we know what that is, we can apply the changes to our thinking, to our heart positions, to our motivations, to our philosophies, to our view of the nations, to see them as God sees them. And that gives us the same activity. We're still prophesying, but we're doing it from a very different place. It's more healthy, more whole.
Yeah. That's wonderful. And I guess how I see it also regarding to that prophetic ministry, that is that you are more focused in. Like you said, of course, you need sometimes words to knowledge, word of knowledge to right. To bring healing into people, right. Some issues maybe. But the view is to bring that transformation so people can accomplish what the Lord has for them.
Yes.
So I think that is really. To bring the prophetic into, from that, as you said, right. The blessing mentality into that productive mentality.
Right.
So,
Pierre, let me ask you a question, if I could. We were together for the last 2 days in this prophetic seminar. I know you have a background in the prophetic that is similar to what I came out of. So what would you say was like a primary thing that you saw or a primary thing that you noted that maybe was different than the emphasis that we had before? What really struck you?
Well, for me, I think it was that grace to bring the prophetic into that line to accomplish what the Lord has put as a potential in people.
Right.
So we have actually, and that is really something that I felt really great when you came, because for some weeks ago I introduced a new prophetic module on this prophetic school we have, and that was, well, we have that name, Acts, because we believe we have to bring that prophetic in from that. That's more. We have maybe blessed people with the words of knowledge and read their life, but we haven't maybe seen so many changes. So our heart is to have that authority to speak the word into existence. And after we put that on our schedule for this fall, actually we have seen that has helped us also to be more focused in how we are releasing a word.
Yes.
And we have seen a moment healing, transformation through that way to see how to bring a prophetic word.
Right.
I feel that is really something that you, through this blog, have introduced. I think that is maybe the most important thing with this today's for me.
I think that's a very good observation. It's one of the primary things that I think is different about what we're experiencing in the prophetic than what we used to. We looked at some verses this week. We looked at the time where Samuel went into Jesse's house and anointed David. He saw him and he poured a horn of oil over his head and he anointed him to be the next king of Israel. And it says that from that day forward, the Spirit of the Lord came upon David. And the phrase "from that day forward" means that the voice of God, whatever you want to call it, a prophetic word, the voice of God, whether God talks to you in a dream or through the scriptures as you're reading or through a prophet laying hands on you, whatever the mechanism is, it's the voice of God. It's divine energy coming from a realm that is not mortal. And it invades the mortal realm. In this case, it invades a boy's life named David. He's a young man, maybe 15, 18 years old. And it says that the Spirit of the Lord came upon him from that day forward, meaning it put David on a track of development. He went from a boy to a king. He went from a young man, that he killed a lion and a bear and a giant, and he served Saul. And after a while, he was ordained king of Hebron and then king of Israel. And he became so dominant in the spirit realm, so correct. Because he grew, he established a throne. And it says Christ sits upon the throne of David. Now, there's no throne of David without progressive, incremental development. There's no throne of David without a man hearing from God and then aligning his life to what God said. So if God says, "I want you to be a king," you can't just say, "Hallelujah, I'm going to be a king." You have to discipline yourself. You have to crucify your life. You have to treat people justly. You have to have a heart for the people of Israel. It says that David led them with the skillfulness of his hands and the purity or the correctness of his heart. He had to become that king that could administer justice and correctness to the entire nation. He had to have his priorities right. That's development. How many kings today, all they care about is their economy. All they care about is trade. All they care about is demographics. David cared about the Ark of God. He brought it back from the Philistines and he put it in the house of God. Even when he failed, he didn't stop. He went back to God and said, "Teach me the right way." So you see David growing, developing, ascending, and becoming mighty and powerful because God talked. Therefore, we can say every time God talks, people grow. Every time the voice of God comes, we develop. So we don't go home the same way we came. So therefore, having a prophetic meeting or prophetic seminar is not primarily focused on how powerful the words are. It's primarily focused on, it's focused on, now that God talked, how do I have to develop? So and what that means in a practical way in our churches is we have to change the culture of our churches. Because in the past, the culture has basically been celebrating the meeting, celebrating the prophetic word, celebrating the speaking of God. And we have to shift that. And now what we're celebrating is not the word so much as the process of development that the word produced. That's what we're looking at. Our focus, our priority is not on, wow, what a great word you got last week. Our focus is, God talked. Are you growing? Are you maturing? Are you changing? Is your marriage being built? Because God talked to you, and you now have a responsibility. That's a very different focus. And if the culture of the church celebrates the meeting too much, it actually diminishes the power of development. People are geared to give priority to what we focus on and celebrate as leaders. So as pastors, as leaders, as prophets, we have to tell the people, yeah, we're going to have a meeting. Yeah, we're going to have prophets. They're going to prophesy to us. But listen, what this is going to do is elevate us into Christ. It's going to make our marriages stronger. So you can't, you know, have a word from God and continue to be carnal. You can't get a word from God and your marriage is broken and weak. You can't get a word from God and still be afraid and lacking confidence. You can't. That's why you see, like, Jeremiah. I love Jeremiah. He's like my hero. He's like my brother. I read Jeremiah, I see me. Because God told him, don't be afraid. I was afraid when I got called by God. And Jeremiah says, you got the wrong guy. I can't do this. I'm weak. I'm a child. And God told him, don't say you're only a child. I require you to change. Do not say I'm only a child. You must go to everyone I send you to and say whatever I command you. And so when Jeremiah said, I'm only a child, he wasn't lying. He was immature. And God was telling him, I will mature you. When I talk to you, I gave you a package of grace that will make you strong. And it made him strong. And he becomes a little priest to a big, strong prophet of God. And you see, in one chapter, we don't know how long it took. You know, the details are not given. Was it days? Was it weeks? Was it months? We don't know. But in the beginning of Jeremiah 1, he's a weak child. At the end of Jeremiah 1, God tells him, this day I have made you a fortified city, an iron pillar, a bronze wall. It's like, I made you? Now, we never thought about the prophet as making us. We thought the prophet blessed us. But when God talked, it made Jeremiah. And he was able to stand, really, as a single voice with massive persecution in the nation. He never compromised because God made him a fortified city, a bronze wall, an iron pillar. That's how we want to be made. When God talks, pillars get made. When God talks, cities get fortified. When God talks, we don't cry. It doesn't say God talks, we cried. It says God talked, we get strong. So our focus has to change. It's okay to cry. It's okay to laugh. It's okay to say thank you. But that's Sunday. What about Monday? What about Tuesday? What about Wednesday? So in our churches, we're changing the culture, and we're saying we're not celebrating the fact that God talked. We're celebrating the fact that when God talked, it put me on a track of growth. And we can look at that. As pastors, we can mentor people. So we have a process in which we actually will take that prophetic word. I'm sure you guys do something similar, where you write down the word so you make sure you know what he actually said. We have a process where we write down the word, and then we sit down with each of our members and we go over. It takes time, it takes effort, it takes diligence. So our pastors and our leaders will go over prophetic words and we'll look for implications and processes. Because there's some things that God says that are obvious, but there's some things he only implies and he expects us to get it. He's kind of sneaky, and I mean that in a good way. He hides things and he wants us to come look for him. And so he'll talk to us like, I got saved. I told the story today, Pierre, in the meeting. I got saved when I was 21, and he talked to me. He said, I've called you to this, and I've called you to be a prophet, and I've called you to that. That's what he said. But what was implied, and this is what God imparted to my spirit, what God imparted and what he implied is, if I've called you to be a prophet, you better prepare yourself. He was calling me to preparation. He was calling me to death to self. He was calling me to sacrifice. He was calling me to study and to righteousness. He didn't say that. He implied that. And we have to learn to speak his language. And it was like a supernatural impartation. I'm not sure how to describe it. Because nobody told me that in 1980. They just told me, what a great word. Well, a lot of people around me got great words. God's no respecter of persons. He calls many. Many are called, but few are chosen. And in that room in 1980, thousands of people got prophetic words. Few of them now have fulfilled those words. They got called. They didn't get chosen. They didn't go through a process of development. They didn't understand that God was saying, you have to change, you have to grow. Somehow, he helped me understand that. And it put inside of me a desire to develop. That was 30-something years ago. And that desire is still there. I'm still growing. I still want to be formed in the image of Christ. And so there's implications. And so we want to sit down with our people and say, what is he implying here? Do you understand this? What's he requiring of you? And we have a system where we have spaces in the prophetic word for people to write in thoughts and implications and then processes. If God said this, what is the process of this thing coming to pass? Or what is the process of this thing being developed? So I've called you to be a growth group leader. I've called you to be a home group leader. Okay, wonderful. That doesn't mean just go start a home group. To become a leader of people, there's issues of compassion. There's issues of wholeness. To be a leader of people means you have to lead your own family first. To be a leader of a group means you have to know the Word of God. To be a leader of a group means you have to be brought into solidarity with the eldership and the leaders of the church. All those things are processes that you have to go through to reach that place of fulfillment, if that makes sense. If you don't stop and think about it, then you're kind of just hoping that one day it'll come to pass. I hope, I believe, God said, you know, we used to talk about the scripture, wage a good warfare with the prophecy that has gone over you. And for us, waging a good warfare was just praying it, confessing it, talking in tongues. I believe God said it, but that's not really warfare. The word warfare there is strategia, and it means to put a plan into place to invade, right? So we have to have a plan to invade those portions of our soul and our heart that fight against and war against the purposes of God coming to pass in our life. And so that's part of our approach. And that whole emphasis that you took from this block on development and maturity is really key and really core to our understanding of the prophetic. It's so strong, we call it a new prophetic dimension. It's not like the old. It's more mature. It's more authoritative. It's more robust. It's more Christ-like. And it produces life in the people.
And it requires a little bit more also.
Yeah, maybe a lot more.
So I think that is also good, even though we have heard about to die to Christ and to lose yourself to gain life.
Yes, yes.
But you know, in these blocks, we have seen that is not just words, but it is more that you see how the Spirit is actually starting working inside you for holiness,
yes.
Inside you for changes, to bear more fruit, and also to see that long-term linear path to walk, to achieve that what the Lord has spoken. Mm-hmm. So that is really awesome. I think we shall have another song here before we will finish with the next question. So we will have a dance here where Valentina is dancing a love song.
Till evig tid du jag kommer inför dig nå för att prisa dig, min Gud. Du allt för mig, du allt för mig. Dude. Gud, min far, min Gud, min far. Takk at jeg kan komme til deg. Takk at jeg kan komme til deg. Du sier ikke du skulle ha vært der i går, og du sier ikke kom tilbake i morgen. Men i dag er nådens tid. Akkurat nå kan jeg komme til deg og gi deg av min sang. For du la i min munn en ny sang, en ny sang, en lovsang. Jeg tilbør deg. Du mitt vern, du min borg, du min tillflykt, hvor jeg kan komme når jeg har sorg. Når jeg nede, så ser jeg på deg. Halleluja, 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 halleluja. Jesu blod som renser meg og gjør at jeg kan komme med stor frimodighet innfor tronen. Bare på grunn av Jesu blod, bare på grunn av Jesu blod, som har gitt meg fyllige ja, som har gitt meg fri tilkrede innfor deg, innfor. Jeg behøver ikke se meg rundt vil omkring, for du er min trygghet, du er min klippe, du er min Gud og min far, ja, min far. Du har omsorg for meg.
Yes, Scott, it's great to have you here in the studio. I think we could maybe define one word that have come through Dr. Noel Woodruff, and also yourself mentioned it, this block, the word confluence. Mm. What does it mean, actually?
Right, the word confluence means many streams coming together into one. Mm-hmm. So it is a blending together, or it's a point of fulfillment. The word confluence, like there's a city in America, Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, in which two or three rivers all come together and form one mighty river, and so it's a point of oneness. It's a point of life making sense. So confluence means that all of the disparate strands, disparate means like extremely varied, things in my life that might not make sense or I might not be able to understand, come into a place of confluence when I realize that God's sovereignty and God's purpose brings everything to a point of resolution. So confluence is personal. It is me coming to a place of understanding God's purpose for me. I suppose the best example of that in the Bible would be Joseph, where he had a very difficult life. He had a word from God. He had brothers who betrayed him. We all know the story of Joseph's life. He was a slave. He was in prison. And these things in the natural didn't really make sense. If you took his original dream, I've called you to be a leader, and your brothers will bow down to you, it didn't make sense why his brothers then sold him into slavery. Those two things almost were like polar opposites. But in God's overarching plan, if God's here and he's looking down at the events of the earth and he's managing things from his position of sovereignty, which he is, then he has a way for all of these disparate things to come together and make sense. So it's Joseph and a dream from God. It's brothers who betray him. It's a woman who tries to seduce him and get mad. It's prison for many years. It's demographic movements, so immigration issues, which are big issues in Europe right now and in America. Issues of people coming into Egypt to eat the grain. It's a confluence of economies where 7 years of plenty and 7 years of famine. You have all these massive factors. You have a man filled with faith, a man filled with obedience, a family that's dysfunctional, demographic movements, economies rising and falling. And all of it made sense when Joseph's brothers finally came and he realized this is what God wanted. God wanted me to feed my brothers. And you see him, it says he separated himself and went into his inner chamber and he wept because he realized that's what God was doing all the time. So our lives are like that in different ways, different details. But confluence is all of these massive events, events in nations, economies, demographic, immigration, political movements, personal faith, trials, difficulties, tribulations. It's all those things coming into one point of understanding where we realize that's what God wants to do. It means that we have no longer unresolved questions. It means we have no longer regrets. It means that he removes the sorrow of our past because the beauty of the journey brought me to this place of confluence or oneness. So that's one personal application. On a big global scale, confluence for us is all of the systems of the earth and all of the purposes of God coming down to one key point, which is the coming of the Lord. When he comes, he swallows up darkness and light. Good and evil is dealt with. The lawless are removed from the kingdom, and all that offend is removed. It's like all these big movements that we can't quite understand on the earth come to a place of understanding and oneness. So the name of our entity is Congress-WBN. Now in English, the word Congress has two meanings. It means both like a governing body, like the Congress of the United States. So there's issues of spiritual government and leadership and dominance. And it does mean that, but the word Congress is also a verb, and it means to congress. To congress means to come together. So in Atlanta, where I live, there's a large hotel and meeting facility, and it's called the Congress Center. And it's where people gather for conferences and for events. It's a gathering place or a place of everybody coming into oneness. So to congress is to move to oneness. To move to oneness is that every aspect of my life, spirit, soul, and body, my married life, my personal life, my family, my ministry, my faith, my job, my career, my finances, all of it comes into the oneness of Christ and is governed by principles of the kingdom of God. So confluence is a simple word, but it has complex ramifications. And it has to do with God bringing ultimate outcomes. One of the images that we use to explain confluence up here is the image of the tornado or the whirlwind. At the top of the tornado, you have a massive funnel cloud. You know, a tornado is like a shaped like a V. It's a funnel. At the top of it, you have all of these random events which look disparate and random and unconnected. But as you journey down to it, it reaches a point, and that's a point that we call a point of light or a point of confluence. So it means that all these things in our lives, which didn't make sense to us 20 years ago or 10 years ago or 50 years ago in my family, God had a plan for all of it and brought it to a place of resolution when we fulfilled divine purpose. So it's a place of like arrival at prophetic purposes being completed. It's a place of fulfillment. The ultimate confluence is the coming of the Lord. The ultimate fulfillment is Jesus Christ returning to his church, taking his bride back home, judging evil, removing wickedness from the earth. Then it says there'll be a new heaven and a new earth. And so it's like when God created in the beginning, he breathed out. And if we can just use the image of a man breathing, it says that God breathed into Adam the breath of life and he became a living spirit. But creation could be seen as like God standing still and breathing out. And when he breathed out, life was created. And years passed and eons developed and the fall of man in the garden when he disobeyed God and nations developed and immigration happened and races got divided and all kinds of things over centuries happened. God stood still, but his breathing out caused massive life to occur all around him. And now in this day and hour, God is breathing back in. He's inhaling. And it's almost like, you know, in the heavens, they have what they call a black hole or a death star. A black hole is when a star implodes and it sucks life back into itself. And when it does that, the gravitational pull is so strong, it pulls everything in. And that's what's happening in the nations right now. What's happening in the nations is God is inhaling. And when he's inhaling, the term in the black hole is the term, and this is in English, I'm not sure how many people will understand this, but it's the term spaghettitizing. Spaghetti is like small noodles or strands. In other words, matter that gets sucked back in gets shredded. And what God is doing is he's breathing in, and nations and economies and systems are being shredded. He created, and now he's destroying. And when he breathes again, there'll be a new heaven and a new earth. That's a point of confluence. Wow. And the thing that's awesome about that image is just the sheer power of God to manage human life and to superintend creation. And we're on a track to that. So therefore, my life is not arbitrary. Whether I live in Norway, whether I live in America, wherever I live in the earth, my life is not just random. I didn't just get saved one day because somebody talked to me about Christ. I didn't just come to a church. God birthed me to be in the earth. When I say me, I mean us, you, all of us. He put us here for divine purpose. We fit somewhere in that apparent randomness. And our process and our development is key. And as we continue to journey towards Christ, we're journeying towards oneness. All things are being resolved. I personally feel incredibly grateful that God picked me. God picked you. He picked all of us here in the audience today. He picked us to be alive in the earth in this point of confluence and culmination. So we have massive responsibility. We could have been born 500 years ago. You would have been a Viking. I would have been a... I don't know what I would have been.
Well,
I would have
500 been a, years, not Viking, yeah. But I catch your point.
I would have been a cowboy in America. I don't know what I would have been. But we're alive now.
Yeah.
And that was by destiny. It's by design. Yeah. And so we're moving towards this place. Doesn't mean they weren't important, but we're living at the fulfillment end of yes. God's ultimate purposes. Mm. And that's a place of confluence. I'm very grateful.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
And I think that's a good word for us all. Shall we give Scott Webster thank you for coming to the Roaring Lamb and Prophetic Voice. Thank you.
That's cool.
Thank you.
Beautiful.